Right. Thanks. Wow. What a turnout. Had no idea. A lot of you all I know I've seen in the restaurants or around town or whatever. Start off with Viljo. My name's Viljo. Everybody asks, how do you pronounce your name? Viljo. Everybody says Filjo. No, it's Viljo, V-I-L-J-O. It's a Finnish name. I was named after my grandfather. In Finland, it'd be pronounced Viljo. I grew up in restaurants, so I'm kind of a restaurant rat my whole life. My parents owned a little greasy spoon restaurant in Oregon. Started out there washing dishes, peeling potatoes when I was 10. Never really got out of the restaurant business, kind of what I've done my entire life now for 30 years. For the past 20 years of it, I've been working in Japanese food with little stints in European and French spotted in there. In 97, I got my start in Japanese food down here at Takara, which a lot of locals or people that travel back and forth would remember Takara back in the day. I left Takara after 3 years of working there and went to Western Culinary in Portland. Studied, you know, restaurant business. I wanted to learn the business aspect of it, the money aspect of it, and, you know, broaden my horizons. I wanted to learn the whys of a lot of things that I was doing. Once I was done with that, I moved up to Seattle and lived in Seattle for 7 years. While I was there, I have a buddy that owns a Japanese restaurant in West Seattle who actually got his start down at Takara. The place is called Mashiko. It's on California Avenue. It's going on 19 years there, 18 or 19 years there. So I worked there in Seattle. I also worked at place called Rovers in Seattle, which you'll see a lot of times on bios about me, like I have this French influence and things like that. It comes from there. Besides culinary school, which is what they focus on is French, there was about a day of Japanese cooking and food. But Rovers, high-end, you know, kind of 4 or 5 star cuisine, Seattle. While I was there though, I moonlighted over at Mashiko, kind of worked both places. I also worked at a place called Cascadia. It's no longer a restaurant in Seattle anymore. It was high-end European food, you know, a la carte menus, prefix menus, things like that. So that's where I kind of got some more influence. While I was working at Cascadia, I was asked to help open a Japanese restaurant. It was a real traditional Japanese restaurant in Belltown, downtown Seattle, named Saito's. Probably the best chef I've ever worked for besides Thierry at Rover's. Amazing guy, classically trained Japanese chef. Didn't go to high school, worked in a restaurant. That's what he did, kind of old school style since he was 13. And then came over to the States and worked in restaurants over here. But he opened up a place called Saito's and I was the kitchen chef for his restaurant. And then after so many years of Seattle, the housing market over there, crazy expensive. Being a cook, couldn't afford it. My wife and I decided we'd move back to Coeur d'Alene. Went back to work at Takara for another 2 years. And then the current place where we're at now, Syringa, the restaurant opened up. So we decided to go for it. And we're going on our 7th year now in April. So. That's a little bit about myself, and again, I love it. A lot of people have been coming in for a long time. I always love to talk food, so if you're in there, come up, say hi. Or if you're not sure about sitting at the sushi bar and think it's a little off or a little weird, it's actually fun, and you meet a lot of cool people up there, and it's a great way to learn about food or get to try food, because for some reason, people always want to share their food up at sushi bar. You know, they're excited that other people are excited about the food they get. So it's something that you should all do at some point, or if you go somewhere else in the world or something, to sit at the sushi bar and have a chance to talk to the chef. It's a real unique experience, and don't be put off if they're Japanese or Korean or Mexican or something else. A lot of people, especially where we live, you know, you have a hard time understanding the foreign accent. Here's the clue. Listen, digest and then respond with it. I've worked with a lot of Japanese people, and you do understand what they're saying. You just have to stop and digest it. It's kind of like talking to a little kid, you know, where if you just take a moment and listen, you can get it. So it's really neat, though. And I just don't want people to be put off like, oh, there's a Japanese guy up there, and he seems kind of standoffish. It's really fun if you go up there and get to know him, and you learn a lot more that way. So anyway, a little bit about myself and things about the restaurant. Next item, we'll get right to it. Making sushi. It's easy. It's not rocket science. There are some tricks, or I don't even think they're tricks, just ways to do things that will help you out. And what I want to do today is show you things that you could do at your home. You don't have to have these, like, I'm going to cut rice. It's called cutting rice, which is mixing in the vinegar into the rice. You don't have to have the big fancy bowl. You could do it in a stainless steel bowl at home. 90% of making sushi is the preparation. And I'm just going to show you some basic stuff overall with that. So basic tools you'll need. It's listed out here. The makisu, the bamboo mats. It's always good to have two of them. One wrapped in plastic and one not wrapped in plastic. $2. I think they sell them here with a little rice paddle, which is something else you'd want to get. I'm not sure what the price is, but the basic stuff you'll need. A bowl to mix the rice and the vinegar, whatever it could be. It could be a stainless steel bowl, whatever. You can use this little guy. At the restaurant, we use this big guy. That's called a hangari, or the slang is a oki in the restaurant. You'll need a knife. Again, people are always excited, what knife do you use? I use a shun. It's good. This style is called a yanagiba. You don't have to have one of these. That one's kind of an expensive one. Here's the same idea, same company, cheaper version. $100, $400, whatever, you know. You don't even need that. You could just use the chef knife, whatever you have. The key is making sure it's sharp. Is one of the main deals. Yeah?
Just, I'm thinking with all this stuff here, for people to be able to see,
I'll move
once
it down.
You get to that. Okay.
And then plastic wrap. Plastic wrap to wrap up your makisu. And then a lot of the rolls you'll see have things on top of them. And the trick to getting that to stick on top is a little plastic wrap over the actual deal. Next thing, some basic ingredients. If you see on the very last page, besides Pilgrim's, which is a great source for a lot of this stuff, they'll have like dashi kombu here, some wasabi stuff. They'll have your nori here, rice obviously here. The two Japanese or Asian markets in Spokane, they're each specific to having certain things. The Bay Market is great for fresh vegetables and things like that. The Asian World is great for sauces and things like that. I'll just go over a couple basic things. Rice. You always see there's like 5 different choices, 10 different choices in any store around town. This stuff I just got at Safeway. They have it in bulk here. Big question I get is, how do you get your rice sticky? Any short grain or medium grain rice is sticky. It's the nature of the rice. So any short grained or medium grained rice is usable for sushi. You don't want to use arborio rice. Arborio rice is what they use to make risotto, and it's too starchy and it won't work, so don't do that. So you'll see a lot of this stuff, Cal Rose rice, or this one's Kukyo Rose. And they're all a Cal Rose. Cal Rose is just a classification of the California rice growers growing Japanese rice. And it just depends on what you want to do. You know, organic's always good. This one is funny because they're kind of going back to the origins of what it was. You know, like everything else, they're trying to get organic is big, of course, as it should be, but you know, they're doing nostalgia on stuff. It doesn't necessarily matter. So, and I'll go over some stuff with this. So Nishiki brand, this is what we use next door. It's just one that I found I like. So it's up to you. If you have a rice that you like, just remember medium or short grained rice. And they're all usable for what it is. Nori, this is the deal. This is a full sheet. Bought it right here at Pilgrim's. These we buy bulk. I mean, we buy obviously a lot more, so for the restaurant, and they actually come cut. And I'm going to show you how to do this when we get to it, so you don't have to worry about how do I cut it perfectly in half. I'm going to show you a little something. Here's something for you. The soy wrap. A lot of people don't like the taste of the nori. So soy wrap, and it's made kind of the same way as you make a paper. They skim off the top layer of soy milk, and then they put sesame seeds. It comes in pink and green and orange and whatever else. I haven't seen this here, but I've seen it at Fred Meyer. I've seen it sometimes at Safeway. At either one of the Asian markets, I've seen it there. The Asian world definitely has this. Bay Market, not so much all the time. Next thing that's needed for when we make our vinegar, this is dashi kombu. And it's just a dried seaweed, big kelp looking guys. You'll see it looks white all over. It's just dried seawater, so salt. So when you use this, you kind of wash it off. And you'll see on the recipes, you know, I put like a 2-inch piece. All you do is take it and break it. For what we're doing, for the size of what we got going on here. Wasabi powder, or wasabi, if you can get fresh, great, use it. If you want to buy the rhizome, you'll see on the extra sheet you have. The rhizome, you're $60 a pound, if you want to use it. This, $20, you probably have it for the rest of your life, you know, unless you're, this is not real. I'll give you guys a hint too. Don't go to a sushi bar and say, your wasabi is so fresh, it's awesome. There is no wasabi in this. Zero wasabi in here. This is horseradish, mustard, yellow number 5, blue number 2.
Blue number 2.
I think that's what it is. Blue number 1, sorry. Blue number 1. No wasabi in here. It is not fresh. It is mixed with water, and it is just paste. If it is fresh, over at the restaurant we use fresh for people that order sashimi assortments and things like that, and we'll put it on there. A lot of people just like this because it is spicier. The real stuff has a little bit more of a sweetness to it. This big spicy bomb, which is fine. If you like it, that's what you like. Do what you like. That's what I say. You're the one eating it, you know. But that's one thing that we look at everybody when they say that. Like, wow, it's so fresh. Like,
yeah.
Not so much. Another thing you'll see on here, togarashi. You can get this at Asian World or either one of those places. Just kind of fun. Japanese 7 spice. Not so spicy spice. Kind of mellow. It's got everything from hemp seeds to orange peel to, it's called togarashi. Yeah. Nanami togarashi, Nanami 7 spice. And you can get this anywhere. Again, this pack, they sell it like this, or they sell it in these little bottles. And maybe you've seen those little bottles at other Japanese restaurants that you can get and kind of shake on whatever. It's nice because it's not overly spicy. Just another one of those things. You don't necessarily have to have it, but it's a good thing to have. Bonito. I put on here basic recipes, how to make a dashi. I know this is sushi 101, but the other question that gets asked all the time for me is, how do you make miso soup? Where do I get miso soup? This is the two basic things needed to make the soup stock right here. This, katsuo bonito. Bonito's a jack. that they dry and then shave. And it's got a real strong kind of fish flavor to it. And this is what we used. We use these two things and water to make our soup stock for miso soup, besides miso that you put in there. So this is a great thing. They sell it like this, so you don't have to be, you know, like, wow, what am I going to do with that? Again, a lifetime supply or individual little packs. They sell these. This is like $3.
What was the other item called?
Which one? This one? This?
Yeah, the shade.
The green stuff.
The green stuff.
For the sushi.
Oh, dashi kombu, this?
Dashi?
Dashi kombu. And what dashi just refers to soup stock. What we, not to get too technical, but when you make a miso soup, you use a ichiban dashi, which means first stock. When you make tempura, you use a nibon dashi. Basically, you take all that, the bonito, the kombu, you strain it out, you save it, you make another stock out of it, it's called a nibon dashi, and you make things like tempura sauce and stuff like that. So I just kind of put a little quip on there for people, yeah.
In all of yours dry, what is the shelf life of this?
Of a lifetime, you know, for this. Yeah, you know, a long time. Dried wasabi powder, you know, forever as far as I know. I go through it so fast, I don't really know. I mean, a year for sure, you know, but it is dried and I've never, you know, I don't know. I'm sure there is a shelf life, but you'll use it before it goes bad, I would hope. Next thing right here, vinegars. That you're going to want to, you'll see, so we're going to make, I'm making one right here and I'll show you guys how to do it. Rice wine vinegar, and then you'll see in the store seasoned rice vinegar, the two different kinds. No seasoning, which is what I'm using and I'm going to show you, and the recipe uses no seasoning, with seasoning. When they do this in the stores, it's generally a lot sweeter, less salty. And on the recipe I showed you, it's real basic, and you can play around with it, make it more sweet, make it less sweet, make a little more salt to it, do whatever you like to it, but those are the two things. So if you see seasoned rice vinegar, and you happen to buy this, don't add more sugar to this, because it'll be really, really sweet. So when I look for it, I just try to get the plain rice wine vinegar, and then you can create your own out of it, and then you can use this for other things as well. So those are kind of the, you know, basic for that. I have on there also mayonnaise, whatever mayonnaise you like. We use QP, it's a Japanese mayonnaise. It's softer, it's got a little more vinegar in it, so it's not as clumpy hard as our American heavy duty mayonnaise. A good one, again, you can get this at the Asian stores, or use any mayonnaise you like, or make your own mayonnaise. I put on there a hot sauce, one that you would like. We use sriracha in a lot of our stuff. Whichever one you like. A lot of this stuff is just whatever you like. Use that beyond these basic ingredients. Here's one last thing I thought was kind of fun that you can get. Right here, this is pickled daikon radish called takwan. It's a type of oshinko. You'll see on Japanese menus, oshinko maki. And this is just one type of oshinko. Oshinko is just kind of a general term for a pickled vegetable of some sort. It's a type of sukimono is another name for it. A lot of people just assume that this is oshinko. This is a type of oshinko. But it's fun. You can get this, and again, this lasts, I don't know how long this lasts, but it lasts a long time. And it's fun. It's got a great crisp. It's nothing like our American pickles. Next thing that you'll see a lot, the kaiwari radish sprouts. You'll see them, you can buy them, the Bay Market has the best produce. These are daikon radish sprouts. A nice spice to them, spicier than the actual daikon radish itself. Daikon gets big, I mean, I didn't bring one, but this is a daikon, you know. And the ones, I mean, they get giant.
Oh, wow.
So, and they're not as spicy at all. So this kaiwari. And I just brought over a little Oh, nice. Look at this. Pilgrim's does have soy wrap.
Oh, good.
That would have been nice. I had to go buy those somewhere. So. And they also have tamari of some sort. I just learned that I was wheat-free about 6 months ago. So you could look around and find a wheat-free soy. Why they add wheat to soy, I don't know. It's a filler. Soy originally was a byproduct of making miso paste. And then they decided, Kikkoman or whoever decided to add wheat probably as a filler. Flavor enhancer is what I've read, but I don't know what flavor it's enhancing. But you can go out and find that. And again, some people I've heard they love the Hawaiian soy sauce. Some people love the Japanese soy sauce. Kikkoman is a Chinese soy sauce. See, it just depends. Something else made in China. Imagine that. All right, well, that's a good overview of everything. I put on here things to think about when you make sushi. 90% of it is prep. Less is always more. Just make another roll. Everybody wants to put everything in the roll. I've got 5 pieces of fish. I want them all in the roll. Like, no, just make another roll because they'll fall apart. Try new things I put on there. That goes along with sitting at the sushi bar. Just, you know, at our place, I mean, you're sitting that close to your neighbor anyway. It's not like we have any room. You know, see what they're having and maybe try something. You never know. I hear a lot of times like, ooh, I don't like that. It's like, well, have you ever had it? No. How do you know you don't like it? You don't know unless you try it. I say try it. It's a good thing to do. And not everything tastes good together. You'll discover that as you go along. But that's a good basic overview. Now I want to get right to it. Cutting rice. Or first I should do making the rice. I put on here, when you're doing the rice, any of those rices that I showed you, follow the directions on the package. If you want to demystify a lot of how do I keep the lid on and how long do I keep the lid on, what do I do? Costco sells these bad boys right here. $20. Best thing on earth. Tough to mess it up. But first thing you want to do when you get your rice, you measure it out, you're going to want to wash the rice. Cold running water, wash the rice until it runs clear. That'll be, you fill up your container, you wash it with your hand back and forth, dump the water out, fill it back up, and do it until it runs clear. Second thing you're going to want to do, let it soak for half an hour. It cuts the cooking time down. Let it soak for a half an hour, and you could visibly see the difference in, you know, when you started to a half an hour later. After that, the rice cooker doesn't know that, so the rice cooker...
So you have to adjust the...
It's a push and go. It does it by weight, so as soon as enough weight is off of it, it shuts off. So that's how it works. If you were to do it stovetop, your stovetop doesn't know that, so you have to adjust it yourself. You have to use a little bit of logic and, oh, I didn't soak my rice, it's going to take longer. Remember, stovetop, once it comes up to a simmer, you stir it, you put the lid back on it, you let it simmer for another 15, 20 minutes, depending, you shut it off. Don't peek at your rice. It requires the steam. It does help to keep that lid pressure on it and cook. Basic thing, so remember, wash the rice, soak the rice, then cook the rice. Follow the instructions on cooking. It's that simple, and it does make a huge difference. You'll notice, like, if you don't wash your rice, you'll notice that it's sticky. It has just a lot more starch in it. And we don't hit a home run every time on rice next door. We get busy, things happen, but we try to not let that happen. All right, once your rice is done, just going to do this. Can everybody see pretty good with this? I brought this because it's a little bit bigger so I can demo on a large scale. We're going to cut. It's called cutting the rice. Once your rice is done, pop the lid on your rice cooker. Take your lid off. Let it steam off for a few minutes. You'll see when the steam dies down. Then take it out. and we're going to put it in here in our big bowl. I'm going to show you also just in a stainless steel bowl, so you don't have to think like, oh my gosh, how am I going? I don't have one of these things. You can buy one of these. They make them this big. But again, I don't think you need a $70 item to cut the rice, you know, type of thing. So we're going to pile the rice up just on one side of whatever it is, stainless steel bowl. I'll actually do that too. So back here, I cooked some rice. I'm just going to let it steam off for a second while I'm showing you on this, and then I'll show you. Vinegar solution. We're just going to pour it over the rice. And you're going to let that sit on there for a second. And basically, while we pile the rice up on one side, we want it to all go through the rice. Just let it sit there for a second. And then we're going to flip it over. And I'm doing this, normally we have a giant, I've got a big rice paddle, but it won't matter too much. You're going to fold it over itself again. And basically what we're doing is letting the vinegar run through the rice several times so it gets all through there. And I know a lot of this may seem real basic, but it is like the important thing of making the sushi roll.
What happens if you just stir it?
It clumps together. It gets real, you'll work the gluten in the rice, and it'll become super clumpy. So when you'll see when I start cutting the rice, I'm going to run my paddle through it like this, and I could push down a little bit, but it's a motion like this. You don't want to push it. You don't want to stir it up. It works the gluten, then you'll have a real clumpy, sticky, ooey gooey kind of rice. So once it's gone through there, I'm going to do it's called cutting the rice. Just kind of. It's kind of an eyeball amount. I do it till it looks a little bit wet. I like to say for our 40 cups that we cook next door at a time, 40 to 50 cups, about 2.5 cups of vinegar to 3 cups. It's kind of an eyeballing amount, you know. And I know that's kind of obscure, but you'll get the hang of it. You know, you're not going to nail it the first try, probably not even the second try, but you just got to stick with it. Remember, you know, if it doesn't turn out, it's rice and vinegar. Yeah, and it'll still taste good. You just come up with something else. And if you have to throw it away or put it in the compost, you know, you're tossing away a couple bucks. It's not going to be the end of the world. I don't think you'd want to put vinegar in your compost, but.
If you don't get right to your rice while it's warm, can you use it like an hour later?
Kinda. It doesn't work. Even the 20 minutes I've been talking here, this rice is. You got to work it a little bit more. What happens is it dries out a little bit too much. The reason why you want it to steam off is you want it to be able to absorb some of the vinegar solution. So that's why you let it steam off. If you just take it out, pour the vinegar on it, it's got a lot of steam moisture and everything like that in it, and it's not going to come out the same. So that's basic right here. Get all the little, try to get as many of the rice kernels off the edge of this as you can, the side of it, because what'll happen with those, they'll dry out. They'll fall in there and then you'll be eating crunchy rice, which it happens sometimes. I mean, sometimes there's not a lot you can do. So that's it. Basically, you want to. So I was cutting it, and I don't know if you could see very well, but I was running the little rice scoop through here, back and forth, like this, making it to a nice, even layer. And the advantage of having this, it's wood, it absorbs excess moisture, it's large, it cools down quicker. Whatever, obviously, you're not gonna have that at home. But what you might have at home, stainless steel bowl, little rice cooker, cooked rice. And I did this just so you guys could, I don't want you to loosen it up. Pour your rice in, see all the steam. Yeah, move it all over to one side. Can't see it back there. And just let it steam off for a second. Just get some of that off there. While that's doing that, I'll finish up over here. So what I've got going on over here, I'm cooking a dashi. I started a dashi, but I started our vinegar too, and I wasn't used to this stove, so it wasn't coming up for me. But it's about there. So I have our recipe that I wrote down. So it's about a half gallon of vinegar, a pound and a half of sugar, 4 ounces of salt. So real simple. You could either bring this up all together, put it all on the stove, all together, or you can bring the vinegar up. And what I have in here is a piece of kombu. I believe I wrote on there about a 2-inch square. Started out like this, it is now. I don't have tongs, but it grows pretty large. Okay, so this is the kombu. And so all I've done, vinegar on, it's about up to boil. When it's there, I'm just going to add my sugar, salt. And again, adjust. If you use that recipe and like, gosh, Viljo's crazy, that's so sweet. Make it again, use less sugar. I like my stuff salty, put more salt in it. The one thing about the salt is try not to go too crazy on it. Remember, when you're done, you're probably going to dunk your stuff in type of soy sauce. It's going to add to it. So sugar adjusted, salt adjust a little bit, and it's one of those things, it's kind of like the trade secret, every sushi bar has their vinegar recipe that they use. I don't know, I've been this same recipe, this parred down quite a bit. I've been using the same recipe for 20 years now. The guy Saito that I worked with over in Seattle, he had a ceramic bowl that was his measuring thing, and he's had it for like 30 years. I'm like, what happens if you break the bowl? He didn't even know how much it held. He just knew it was 3 of these bowls of sugar and 8 ounces of salt. I'm like, what happens if the bowl breaks? He's like, I'm screwed. it was kind of funny. I'm like, really? So I measured it out one day. I did. All right. So, and that's it. I'm just going to bring this up, let everything dissolve in there, shut it off, and it's good to go. You put your vinegar in a Tupperware solution or a Tupperware container, label it, good to go for a long time. Whatever, once you figure out what you want. So our rice is steamed off. I'm doing the same thing I did in that big bowl. The difference here, something to pay attention to, exactly, it doesn't absorb. Yeah?
If you store it and you want to use it with the rice, should it be heated first?
Nope, should be room temp. If it's hot, you'll use less of it, but it'll cook the rice. And then you'll have overcooked rice again. So
how long did you boil that for?
I just brought this up to temperature.
Yeah.
To boil basically, and then dissolve the sugar and salt, and then you're done. Right. Thing to remember on this guy, it's not going to absorb any excess liquid, so go slow on it. You can always add more. You can't really take anything away. So that's where the big wooden oaky there gives us a little bit of leeway with it. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm just going to turn it over itself a few times. And when I do this, because I don't, there's no absorption, you're going to see I'm going to cut it and kind of put it around the edge of the bowl, which will help. If there is any excess, it'll run towards the middle of the bowl and help you out that way. And it'll help cool it down faster too. So, and again, I'm just cutting it, running it through there, trying to get a nice even distribution of the vinegar on the rice. And then up the side of the bowl to let it cool down. And it's going to take a little bit longer to cool in this, because the metal, you know, again, it's not absorbing moisture, it's not absorbing anything excess. Once it's hot, it's kind of hot. That wood bowl we spray down with cold water. Just that simple, at home. Do it at home, don't need the big wood bowl, whatever. Like I said, you could go buy one of the wooden bowls. They make them that are this big that you could do at home, but. All right, well that is cooling off before we get to making our rolls. The dashi and the miso soup is something that, again, I think it's kind of a sidebar on what we're doing today. But it's one of those things a lot of people ask me, how do you do this? I love your miso soup. What do you do? It's got to be tough. It's not tough at all. Here, I'll use one of these. What I have in my pot here, water, a piece of 2-inch piece of dashi kombu, which is this stuff right here again. That's all. I rinse off the white on it. I just run it under water, get off excess salt. The miso is going to have enough of it. So, can you see that in the back? I don't want to tilt this one. So again, here's the kombu. It's just water and kombu so far. And then I'm going to add the katsuo bonito. And again, I showed you the big bag of it, big flakes of it. Here's the same idea. It's just obviously home use for this much. I don't know what this, you know, how much this is. All you do, once this was boiling over here, all you do, once it's boiling, you add your bonito flakes and shut it off. They're sliced so thin that the flavor distribution happens really fast. So you don't have to leave that on there and boil it for, you know, 15 minutes or anything like that. It's pretty much on, up to a boil. Add your flakes, shut it off. That's all you have to do, and you're ready to go. So we did that right here, strainer into another pot. All we're going to do is strain it. And you have a fish broth. Real basic ichiban dashi. Dashi. You see things that say dashi on it. This is what they're referring to. Vegetarians out there, remember miso soup. If it's true miso soup, it does have fish in it. So it can be made without it. I just skip the bonito flakes and just make a kombu stock. Make a dashi kombu stock. You know, there's nothing wrong with that at all. All right, so we have it strained. Strainer back in the bowl. What we're going to do here is use that to add our miso. And I have two different types of miso. I have a red miso, and this just, again, it's all personal preference. There's places that just do a shiro miso. Shiro, white miso. It's going to be a lighter flavor, less robust. The white miso is really good for making sauces and things like that, mayonnaise sauces, whatever you want. The white miso works better than the red miso. real robust, real strong, kind of earthy flavor, and more salty. And I don't like using this for sauces because of all of those characteristics right there. It kind of, it can overpower a lot of everything. So, real basic. You got a whisk at home. You just have to put it in there. Miso's real thick and sticky. For this much, I don't know what this is, maybe 3 ounces, maybe less than 3 ounces. But I'm using, here, let me move this so you can see a little bit better. I'm using the whisk and the strainer. It helps break up the miso. Just, you can buy miso pretty much anywhere. What's that?
The paste.
The paste you can buy pretty much anywhere. Again, I don't know if Pilgrim's has this. I've never... See, there you go. Pilgrim's has it. And it's great. And if you're buying it, make sure you do buy an organic miso paste. They found that soybeans that they use to make this, and if it's not organic, is actually worse for you than what you would... you would think. So, and that's it. So what I did, equal amounts, and again, this is just my preference. Do whatever you like. If you like the red miso only, use that. You like the white miso only, use that. Again, this is just my personal preference, what I've done for years. A couple things about miso that you want to be aware of. You can kill it. It's kind of like a live culture. If you look at it, if I let it settle here, you'll see it. It's kind of like clouds in here. It'll start bubbling and it looks really, I don't know, it looks kind of cool. It's like clouds in your coffee or something. Yeah?
Is all miso fermented?
Yeah, that's how they make it. Yeah, it's a fermented soybean and rice. And they put it in these, well, they probably don't do it anymore. They probably pressure cook it and let it sit and ferment. And again, that's where the original soy sauce came from. The liquid that leached out of the barrels on top, this real brown, sticky liquid, was the original soy sauce. So I don't know if you can see that or not, but it kind of looks cloudy and cool. It's one of those things, once you do it enough, like I can tell right now this is fine. It's probably enough miso. You could look at it and say, oh, it needs more something. It doesn't float, it doesn't flow, it doesn't look like this. You could add more. It's just that easy. I just wanted to show everybody, because this is, again, something just super basic that is real, real easy to do at home. And don't buy the ondashi. You'll see that little powdered stuff, ondashi. I don't want to say you don't, but don't. It's too simple, and the ingredients are all dried, and they last for a long time. So you could have them in your pantry, and it's not going to go bad. The miso lasts for a really long time. It's sold in refrigerated sections. So Pilgrim's does have it. It'd be in their refrigerated section. Yeah. That's it. And then for the condiments that go in there, we use green onion, diced tofu, and wakame. And wakame is a dried seaweed. And wakame expands by about 15 times its normal size, so be careful if you use it. Well, you'll see. You'll be like, that's nothing. And then, oh my gosh, that's a lot. And that's it. I've been other place. That place, Saito's, we put aburage in it, which is a fried tofu. Yeah.
How do you spell wakame?
W-A-K-E. I need a wakame. Wakame.
Got a paper.
Yeah, like I have to see. I think that's close though. Yeah, wakame. And it's sold again in like a little pack, little pieces, flakes of it. Each one of those places will have it, or should have it. Again, you know, this stuff is just really simple, and I think it's better if you make your own, and then you could come up with your own recipe, and you could put whatever you want in there. There's a great recipe where you put clams in it. It's called a sari miso, which is crazy good. Again, it's up to you, whatever you want to put in there. Right. Now to the fun stuff, huh? Some rolls and things like that. Real quick thing about the rolls, you'll see on the page here. The one that I typed up here, the real simple, basic stuff. Three basic types of rolls that we do all the time at the restaurant. Rice on the outside, seaweed on the outside, and hand rolls. Those are the three basic types. There are more than that, obviously, but those are the three basic types. So you got uramaki, that's rice on the outside. Hosomaki, seaweed on the outside. Teimaki, that's the hand roll. Japanese terms for all those. Again, real basic. And I just put a couple basic rolls that are on pretty much every sushi bar menu anywhere. I didn't want to go crazy with, I could have given you a whole roll list over there, but just come up with your own thing. That's more fun than following the recipe, you know, per se. Makes it a little bit more fun. All right, let's get right to it. Nori, you always need the nori. This one comes cut in half, but I'm going to show you because they don't always come cut in half. And people always wonder, like, well, I'm not that good with knives. How do I do it? Do small stacks if you want. There's probably, fold it in half. Make sure it's in half. Just like that. So, pretty easy, huh? And the guys at work, I don't know, you know, there's something to do with ego at work where the guys at work want to cut it in half. I've been doing it forever and I fold it in half. It's, you know, whatever. When I'm at work, I care. And it's one of those things, I'm always like, who cut the nori? Because you'll have something that's, you know, off kilter. So I'll just finish doing these up real quick. But just that simple. When you do it, it's good to do it over a little garbage can. You'll see all sorts of little flakes. You can collect all those little flakes and put them on your rice too. That's really good. It's called kizami nori, is what that's called. The little flakes of. So a lot of people think, or I've talked to people, think that you roll sushi on this. You roll it on half of this. And they're always, even some sushi bars roll it on a full sheet, which it's just a little bit too much. Right. So there's that. Avocado, easy basic ingredient. Everybody know how to open up and get an avocado out and everything like that? Cut it in half. Already did it. Little twist, seed, comes out. I like to cut them in half again. And then if you just take from the pointier end, you can peel an avocado super easy. And it's again, one of those things. Everybody, a lot of people will use a spoon. If you use a spoon, what you end up doing is kind of cutting this a little bit, and it makes it real slick. It releases some of the oil, and it makes it harder to handle. If you just get nice, ripe avocados, you peel it off. This is actually kind of dry, easier to handle. They're already in sections that you can use. Right, kaiwari. This is probably one of the toughest ones to prep right here. Take it out of the container like this. Cut the little sponge off. That's it. Kind of exciting, huh? All right. Cucumber. This is one that can be a little daunting, or you've seen the sushi guys up there peeling the stuff with their knife. Real simple. The kind of oblong pointy end. We cut it off. Take the little plastic deal off. Always like to wipe it down. Measurements. Your hand, whatever hand it may be, what we're going for is this size right here. Okay? You could even put your piece of nori down here. And the reason is the two pieces will fit inside and it'll be this, the length of that. So, can you all see up there pretty good? No? All right, so all I did is use my hand and cut off around. This is kind of the easiest way. Cut off around. Cut off around. That's all I did. So far, so good. Now we're just going to cut it in half. Cut the round in half. Now we're going to cut that in half again. So cut them into rounds, then cut them into halves, then cut them into halves again, or I guess it would be quarters at that point. So we have that. So here's what you end up with. Seeds, don't want the seeds. Take your knife, a little bit of an angle, and you're just going to cut the seeds out. And the reason for it, the seeds are really wet. You could leave them in there if you really want. It's your deal. But they're really wet, and it'll be tough to work with on your sushi. So that's, again, a little bit of an angle. Go and cut out the seeds. You can do, you know, one cucumber at home, I would assume, would be enough. And again, a lot of what you're doing is the preparation. Because once you have everything done, it's going to be pretty simple.
So you don't peel those?
Do not peel them. English cucumber is what this is. English. So you end up with this little piece, and you'll get, now you're going to cut them into sticks about like this. So for each one of these, you get about 4 sticks. And there's all sorts of ways to do this. Like I said, you see sometimes those guys up there, or me up there, like peeling the daikon radish. Some restaurants, that's how they like it. I don't like it like that because some of the cucumber gets really small. The places do it because they think it's faster, I think. But it's not necessarily.
How do we keep our knives sharp at home?
Find a good knife sharpener in town. Bitterroot Cutlery, I know he'll sharpen knives. Remember at home your steel. You see all the chef types using the steel, you know, doing their knives like that. That is not meant to sharpen your knife. It's meant to keep the blade on it straight. So just find a good knife sharpener. I don't really know. I sharpen my own knife, so I don't know who in town does a good job. I know Bitterroot Cutlery does it. That's about all I know of. So you could go there and he just runs it on a machine. You know, your chef knife, he's just going to put it on a machine and make it sharp. That's kind of what he does. All right, so we got our basic ingredients for the inside or for our rolls. Next thing I want to show you, get some of this out of the way. As I put on there our basic recipe for spicy tuna, spicy scallop roll. They're both the same thing. Again, it could be whatever you would like to do. I just put what we do on there, type of deal. So, in a great place. A lot of people always ask me, where do you get tuna? What do you do? What do you want to do with the tuna? Well, I want to chop it up and make spicy tuna mix. You could come to Pilgrim's, go to the Fish Folks here on Thursday and get it. You go to the Fisherman's Market and get it. I've seen it at Costco and get it. Wherever you get it, you know, just buy something that looks yellowfin tuna. Nothing wrong with it. Then you'll see it vacuum packed sometimes, and it's really pink and really a weird color. And that's because they inject it with a gas to try to maintain the color. And I would say out of all of that, I don't like that. I try not to use that at all.
Is there anything that they do if it's going to be used for sushi to make it safer?
Not that I know of. You know, the most commercially caught tuna is frozen at sea. Then it goes into the markets. You'll see it in the markets. They cut the tail open so you can see what the meat looks like. And then they have people that bid on the fish. And that's how it's done. It's like a big auction for fish, for tuna, just like anything else.
Do you have any idea how old the fish is?
Not for tuna and stuff like that, no. I mean, salmon, you can go, you know, it's 2 days out where we're at. We're blessed for being in the Northwest, you know.
How old should be the oldest that you would use?
I'm not sure. I've never used, as far as I know, any really old tuna. So, here's how you can tell. Like, if you cut it, and it's got like that oil slick to it,
yeah,
that oil slick look to it, you can tell it's getting up there in age. I just watched a great movie you all should watch. It is called Jiro Dreams of Sushi. And they age their tuna for like 10 days. They cut it and wrap it and let it sit for 10 days like you would, I'm assuming, like a beef. You know, beef you age a lot longer. But I thought that was really interesting. And Jiro's 10-seat sushi bar, 3 Michelin stars, the only one in the world. The guy's 85 years old, still makes sushi.
Now, where is this?
In Japan.
Ah.
It's in Ginza Station in Japan.
Oh.
They don't even have a bathroom inside. It's a really cool show to watch, though. It's called Jiro Dreams of Sushi. Documentary, 85-year-old guy, still making sushi. And that's all you get there is sushi. You don't get rolls. You don't get any stuff like that, nothing. All right, so for the tuna, you'll get it. There's 2 different cuts here. I brought them so you could see. See the one on the bottom with all the grain in it, and the other one on top? It's called a tenmi, this would be the top of the loin, and this would be the bottom of the loin, closer to the skin. We like to use this for our spicy tuna mix, because you can cut across a grain, and it's fine for eating it as sushi and everything like that, but we like to do it for our spicy tuna. Besides, we scrape the meat off the skin also and use it for a spicy tuna. So in case you're ever wondering why it's kind of mushy or whatever, it's because it's, with a spoon, it's just scraped off and then mixed up. You can have it diced up and everything like that, but it's a usage item, spicy tuna and things like that. It's a usage item. So all I'm going, spoon, hold it in my hand, and just scrape it off. And so what I'm trying to do here is see all that sinew and the silver skin?
Yeah.
Is leave that on the cutting board. And so all I have is the meat aspect of it. Like that. So you have all the silver skin, because you can't really chew it up, you can't really do anything with it. It is there. So this is another reason why in sushi bars you'll see it done like this, or you'll be like, why is it all kind of mashed up? And that is why. So I'm just going to do a quick...
What were the 2 different cuts called?
This is a tenmi.
Tenmi?
Tenmi is the top part, and saku is the second part. And if you'll notice, my saku, it's kind of late now, again, my saku, like the cucumber, like the nori, it's all your measurement is here. And however, some people have big hands, some people have little hands, adjust accordingly if you need to. Okay? So we're just going to take this off as much as we can. If you get a little bit in there, it's fine. You know, again, you want to use as much as you can at home, because you're right now, tuna's my cost about $18 a pound. So your cost, if you go out and get it, you're, I don't know what you're at, $26 a pound, which is crazy. Another weird one right now is eel. A lot of people have had unagi. Unagi is now the most expensive thing we carry.
Really?
If you can believe that. A farmed raised eel out of China, $18 a pound.
That's out of China.
Out of China. How crazy is that? That's more expensive than our crab. And we use a Dungeness crab that's $17.79 a pound. And all this stuff, fish, whatever you use, whatever you want to use, whatever you find you like, try to use as much as you can the real products. I'm kind of anti-fake crab and stuff like that. I'm one of those. If you can't have it, it's probably your body telling you you can't have it, and find something else. Because to use a surimi crab mix is kind of funky.
What kind of fish is it?
It's a surimi. It's a, like a little white fish. Back in the day, they used to use a lot of cod and stuff like that. Just one of those things. All right, so for our, for what we do, our little mix there. We use a little togarashi, a little mayonnaise, a little spicy, a little sriracha. And here's how I mix it up. Just a basic, easy way to mix it up. You want it spicier, add more. You don't like mayonnaise, don't put it in there. Mayonnaise, to me, it just makes it a little bit more creamy, and it's kind of fun. And then a little bit of togarashi here, which again is the seven spice, Japanese seven spice. You get it all scraped off, it's on your cutting board. I just use the knife and kind of chop it all up together, which mixes it. Again, preparation, preparation. We're doing this spicy scallop mix, real basic, same idea. We're just gonna have to chop that up though, because scallops are really soft, so you don't even have to worry about it. And that's it. You can put green onion in here. I think I put on the list green onion. Again, whatever maybe you would want. And you're coming up with kind of chopped, diced up, chopped up, kind of mushed up, if you will. It's a real technical term, I know, but. All right, the next one. Spicy scallop. Again, real common, real easy. This one is one of my favorites. And when I found out I was allergic to wheat, I was so glad I was not allergic to shellfish. This one. Again, real similar, real easy. You see scallops. I don't know if we have one on here. Sometimes you'll see them. They'll have this little piece right here. This little hard piece. It's called the foot. Just take it off. It's just hard. You could chop it up too if you want. Just cleaner product if you take it off. Just going to chop it up. This one's nice. Again, I like it. Real creamy, real nice, rich texture. Real easy to work with. That's why I picked these two things to show you. Both of them real easy to work with, real moldable in the roll. So when you're rolling it, just it's easier. It's good beginner stuff to do, along with crab and stuff like that. Real easy. Oh, sorry. Did I get you? Nice. I get you? No, you're good. That's why we need the dog. Where's the dog at? Come, floor cleaner. Same idea. This I put in masago, something I didn't talk about, the seasoned smelt roe. And masago is the one that you have, and it has a sweetness to it. And it's on there. Smelt roe, little ocean run fish, or around here, the Columbia River, you could go smelt dipping. another. Again, just all chopped up. Put in the ingredients. If you want it more spicy, add more spice. You want it less spicy, less spice. That's all you have to do. And again, it's good if you have, you know, don't pull your scallops out and have them all soaking wet. Put them down because it's going to be real wet, and then when you try to roll it, it's going to be difficult to roll. All right, we're almost there. I just want to show you one more piece. Salmon, another real common thing. People around here just love it. Again, cut the width of our hand. If you notice, again, everything is reason for uniformity, works better in the rolls. When you see it belly side or flesh side, bone side, skin side, brown part, nothing wrong with it. In Japan, they would serve this to you, no big deal. In America, we all think it has something. Go ahead.
What are you wrapping the fish in?
The fish was just wrapped in a little paper towel and then plastic wrap for these, and it gets rid of the excess moisture. So what I do, I just cut this off so we can use it. And again, if we were to, you know, so there you go, just cleaned up. This little white piece here is just a piece of the backbone that's on there. We pin bone it. That's that. Right. Final thing, easy prep thing. Your super good fresh wasabi. This one. I like to have it, and you'll see I go for it when it's I like it when it's a little bit on the wet side, more pliable. Maybe you go some places and it's a little bit thicker, a little bit tougher. It's just a personal preference. But this is something, you know, you would think like, well, I could just do that at the end and make it. For the flavors to bloom, it's really good to do it a little bit ahead of time. I know it seems weird to think, seeing how it's not really anything, but it does need a few minutes for all the flavors to come together. So it's another thing you'd want to prep, you know, get done messing with your fish and everything, get your fish in. All we're going to do is add water to it. And I'll show you here, so. And you're just mixing it up till it's a paste. So here. It's just in the water. I use a spatula and I'm just going to mix it until there's a nice paste. And then the joke at work for the new guy, we always ask him to smell the wasabi and see if it's good or not. Because it's... Sometimes it's crazy.
Where did you get your tuna in your salmon?
Tuna, all our fish, all the fish for the most part here in this town, there are three main fish providers: Ocean Beauty, Pacific Seafood, North Star Seafood. And people will say, well, I use FSA. Well, FSA, I believe now they use North Star Seafood. So FSA is just a middleman out of those three. Dale, fish folks guy, he buys his fish from Ocean Beauty. We buy our fish from Ocean Beauty, North Star, and Pacific Seafood. Pacific Seafood and Ocean Beauty are the two largest seafood providers on the West Coast.
Do they sell to
12 restaurants? They are a wholesale only. But if you go to, you know, I don't know who they use specifically here, but phew. Pacific Seafood, they're all great. Again, it's one of those things that we found that you have to constantly source, and one of them does really good for one thing. Like I really like, yeah, you like that? I'm crying, sad. I really like the tuna usually that I get from Pacific Seafood. They seem to kill it a little bit more on tuna. Maybe they have a better buyer. I guess we're blessed in the fact that, you know, I have the ability to do that. Fisherman's Market, they buy from Pacific Seafood. I don't think they use Ocean Beauty at all, type of thing. So just remember that we're all getting our fish from the same three providers for the most part. We do use another specialty company out of Seattle that specializes in Japanese fish in particular. So.
Would you ever use the Costco salmon?
The what?
Would you ever use them? The Costco salmon or tuna?
It depends on what Costco. The tuna at Costco, sure. I mean, if you're going to do what I just did to it, no problem. The salmon, if you notice, they carry a lot of farm-raised Atlantic salmon, which is really common in the majority of all sushi bars carry a farm-raised Atlantic salmon. If you look at it, and it's a nice kind of pinkish, orangish, beautiful fat profile going through it, it's probably a farm-raised Atlantic salmon. We did use that ourselves for the first couple years. Since then, though, we've tried to use exclusively just West Coast king salmon. King salmon. For our cooked fish, we use a sockeye salmon, Randy Houghton white cane salmon, which they use here as well. Great local fishermen. And again, that's a sockeye salmon. We don't use it a lot for sushi because it's there's not a lot of fat in it, so it doesn't have a ton of flavor per se. I mean, it does have flavor for sure, but you know, fat equals flavor in the world of cooking. So that's why we use that. And there's also now out of BC a farmed raised king salmon, which is great. The issue with the farmed raised Atlantic salmon over here, if you get it on the West Coast, non-native species, they do not spawn and die. They live, they spawn and live. All West Coast salmon spawn, they go up the rivers, they lay their eggs, they die. Atlantic salmon do not do that. So the issue is when they break out of the nets, which inevitably they do, you have that issue of, you know, what do we do now type of thing. Because they're out. So nothing wrong with it. Find, again, if you're buying a whole fish, you want to buy a fish, nice silvery, almost slimy, if it's a salmon, clear eyes, real red gills, and you know, you pretty much no issue here. I've seen some really horrid stuff at Safeway and Albertsons, you know, where you look at it and you're like, the meat's all falling apart. That's just an old fish and it's getting dried out and the meat is real funky, but they're buying 1,000 pounds at a time and they don't really care. They're just trying to sell as much as they can sell. Yeah, and it has issues. All right, so for the most part, we have all our prep done. Oh, sweet. Yeah, just over there. Yeah. What is out there for the parasites specifically is what was just asked. The FDA recommends that all our fish is frozen, deep frozen, for at least 18 hours, which kills any fish-borne parasite. The only thing that I've ever known in the sushi business that carries a parasite, freshwater to saltwater fish, is the salmon that we just talked about. And we freeze all of our salmon. Fluke, or like sole fish and stuff like that, definitely have it in it. Black cod generally have parasites, little worms that are in it, in the belly part. It seems gross, but it is just really common all throughout that. Deep freezing kills it, just like pork They solved the pork issue in our country by deep freezing, the trichinosis.
Doesn't it have to be frozen? When you say deep freeze, I mean not just frozen like...
Frozen 18 hours minimum. And that doesn't mean, well, I put it in my freezer last night at midnight and it's 18 hours later. It means once it's frozen, that's when the cycle's supposed to start of it. And I have yet to see any issue with any of it in all my years of doing this. And again, like I said, most commercial tuna is frozen at sea. That's already taken care of. I haven't really noticed anything in other than that. The salmon is the one I always say, err on the side of caution. Freeze it in your freezer if you want, you know, if that makes you feel better type of thing. Yeah?
Would you use the frozen sushi that we can get at Costco?
Yep. Yep. And we actually do that for our spicy scallop mix. There is no issue with it. A frozen diver sea scallop is done really nicely. If you go somewhere and you see Alaska weather vane scallops, those are really great frozen scallops. For our scallop dish, our appetizer, we try to use it's called a dry pack diver sea scallop, which just means it comes in fresh. And there is a law saying that they can, I don't remember what the chemical is, but they can add a chemical to retain water in scallops. And it's up to a certain percent. So what you're buying is water a lot of times. Just keep that in mind. Yeah, as far as the salmon is the only one. I've never used like a sturgeon or anything like that. So I don't know how that would be. I've used smelt, but again, the smelt was ocean run smelt, not a freshwater, not a river run smelt. So that's... Can you use any freshwater fish as long as it's frozen? And I don't know. I just haven't done it. I mean, freshwater eel is used, but it's cooked. I just haven't run into that. Maybe you can, and I haven't... Everything I've researched, that's, I haven't seen a lot of freshwater fish used, so it's all ocean fish. All right, we're ready to make a roll. Let's make a roll. Again, we have our nori sheets. If you notice, two sides, shiny side and a rough side. The rice always goes on the rough side. Rice on the rough side. Rice on the rough side. Rice rough. You always see us dipping our fingers. Everybody wonders what the magic thing is. It's water. We use water with a little bit of vinegar in it at work. Again, natural disinfectant, but real basic, just water. All you're going to want to do, get a little water on your hands, get both your hands kind of wet, damp. Got our rice is cooled down. Another thing with the rice, you don't want it cold. You want it kind of room temp or tempid. Tempid is just body temperature. I went to a real traditional place and their rice was actually a little bit on the warm side. That's kind of what it is. If it's cold, it doesn't mold right. If it's too hot, it won't mold right either. It'll just fall all over. This is about perfect, you know. What was that, the 15 minutes I was talking there? So what we're going to do, our hands are wet. We're going to form a little football shape. And this is what's going to take a lot of practice. It's barely held together. It's kind of formed. I didn't pack it. You're going to have one hand that holds the shape of it. Everybody see, is my head out of the way enough? You're going to place it on the top half of the nori. This hand, or if you're left-handed, it'd be the other hand, but I'm right-handed, so my right hand holds the shape of this rice to about a 2-inch wide area on the nori, and I just move it across. I'm just moving it across the nori sheet. Next thing I'm going to do, I like to form a little corner. Again, this is just my OCD. I make little square corners on it. But the basic technique is you're going to do this, like a little breakdance move, just on your rice. And you're going to push the rice down the nori sheet. like that. I leave a little edge on it right here because that's what's going to tuck up inside of our sushi. So there it is. Little bit of a little space on there. Right, that's going to be the tuck side. I'm going to flip it over. If you got a wood cutting board at home, I like to use wood more than anything. It's actually better than plastic. So we're going to place that down on the wood side. Basic, two cucumber. We cut, right? So they're, you can see that, they fit right inside the roll.
Mm-hmm. It's a water bowl.
Oh, yeah. There you go. There you go. See, that's why I was asking. How's that? Right, see our cucumber that we cut? See how it fits in there? There's a reason why we cut stuff like that. Next thing for these rolls, a little kaiwari. How's that? Can you see? So just a little bit on each side. And then for this, I'll make a spicy tuna roll. And again, this spicy tuna is probably the easiest one to use or to do because it'll stay molded in the roll. And I'm just going to lump up a little bit of it. See that up there in the mirror? Can you see it? Oh, here, I put that in your way again. So right there. So just a little bit right down the middle is what we're doing. And remember, less is more. Everybody wants to put a ton of stuff in here. It just doesn't work good. Messed my groove up. I'm used to over here. No, then we're going to take it. Just like rolling a cigarette or maybe a fancy cigarette you're used to. We're going to roll it over. One end, I'm holding the nori. I know it's tough to see. Basically, I'm just holding this one end. And the whole thing is kind of wrapped over, but we're going to start at one end of it and start tucking it in from one end to the next. So it's all kind of tucked up in there, and we're just going to roll it another quarter turn. Okay, and there's your roll. For the rice on the outside roll, plastic wrap maki su. Over the top of it, squeeze the sides a little bit. Don't kill it, because you could squeeze everything out of it. You just want to form it. Squeeze the sides of it, a little bit on top. So basically what I go for, what I like to see, flat sides, a little bit of round on top, and a flat bottom on it. There's the bottom. Okay, just like that. Super easy. After 10,000 of them. But here, I'll do it again. So again, so we have our nori. What side is up? Rough side, because we're going to put the rice on the rough side. Little football-shaped rice ball. Kind of, it's held together just barely. I mean, it's about ready to fall apart because you want to be able to manipulate it. About a 2-inch swath across the top of the nori sheet. Little excess, just put it back in your bowl, whatever you got. I like to square up the corners because I'm just that way. This motion, we're going to kind of pull the rice across the nori. Pull and down. A lot of people are afraid to move or touch or like they're going to smash the rice, but you're not going to. And I know it's a little difficult just having me, you know, you'll show you. It's better when you do it hands-on. So there we are again. We have our rice on the nori, a little bit, like a quarter inch, I guess, at the bottom. And again, this is, you could go all the way to the bottom if that makes you feel better, if that's your thing. Go all the way to the bottom with it, that's fine. So we're going to flip it over. Cucumber, because that's what we do in this one. If you want, avocado.
Yes.
Here. Avocado. I slice my avocado on an angle, like it's already on an angle, so I just slice it like this. You can, and everybody see that avocado? However you want to cut it, and you could pre-cut it You can go straight down if you want. Nothing wrong with that, so it's cut straight down. Again, you know, just so it's in there, I cut it across. Just to me, it seems to work better. And again, what kind of roll is this called? Does anybody remember? Oh, I was looking for uramaki. Just saying. Rice on the outside, right? Uramaki.
Would you use this, the rough side, if you had the sushi, the wrap on the outside?
What side does the rice go on? It's always the rough side. And I'll show you that right now. So, uramaki. Now we're going to do a hosomaki, and you'll see these a lot of times. These are traditional rolls. We start it the same way, kind of. Rough side, rice. I leave the quarter inch on top, though. Remember how it was on bottom? You could always leave it on bottom and just spin your roll all the way around. On this roll, it really matters, though, that you leave this little quarter inch. So before I put it on the bottom, or whatever, still on the bottom, but for me, here. So we'll do it. It's going to be on top. We're going to put this corner to here. And that's why it's important to leave this so it actually wraps up in there so you can, it'll hold together better. And this is where you need your maki su that has no plastic on it at all. So we're going to take this and lay it on top of it, right at the edge. This one just requires a little bit more manipulation. Again, our cucumbers. This roll is called a kapa maki, traditional roll, just cucumber roll. A lot of times they'll put a little wasabi, so for this one, right along in it, a little bit of wasabi. Hold our mat. We're going to hold the ingredients in the center of it. Again, we're just going to put the corner or the mat right down on top of, right to the edge of the little quarter inch that we left. So once we do that, once it's to the edge, we just roll it another quarter turn. And again, I'm flexing it or pushing down on it the same way I did for the rice on the outside. Flat sides, kind of rounded top. That is it. And then you end up with that. Here's the bottom. So that overlaps a little bit. Rounded top, flat sides. And that's what that is. Here, I'll do another one for you real quick. Any questions or anything? Seem easy enough? Yeah. The roe, we get it from one of those companies. I have seen it at Fisherman's Market. Fisherman's Market carries a lot of this stuff. Fisherman's Market's up on Kathleen. Like they actually have a lot of, like they'll sell you a bunch of sushi stuff. So again, rice on it, little quarter inch on top. Take a little bit of wasabi. If you want, you don't have to put it in here. Oh, where's my avocado? Then we'll do an avocado roll. Maybe two of these. Spicy scallops. Hold on. So again, hosomaki. Traditional roll. The reason why the seaweed's on the outside, most sushi, we have an etiquette page on there. Nigiri sushi, finger food. These rolls, finger food. If you go to a sushi bar and you get those little towels, is to clean your hand off before you eat. Not after you eat, not while you eat, before you eat. Because nigiri and these traditional rolls are meant to be eaten with your hands. Not everybody does that. It's But that is why. One of those things. Sashimi with your chopsticks. Sashimi's chopsticks. I explained that one time to some people, and sure enough, they used their fingers for the sashimi, which was a little barbaric. All right. Hand roll, teimaki. Real common one, real fun one. We're going to fold this. Rice goes on the rough side, just like the other rolls. We're going to fold this one to make a little cone. We're going to fold it like you would an airplane and just roll it up. Okay. A lot less rice though. We're just going to use a little bit. What you want on this one is kind of a kite shaped piece. Old school kite, I guess. Like this. Everybody see that? Just right on the corner. A little cucumber if you want, a little kaiwari. It's a radish sprout. I like the radish sprouts on these spicy rolls. Just add a little brightness to it. And then I'm going to add a little bit of spicy scallop mix. And again, what you're going to do, so this corner up to the top of the nori sheet, and just roll it. And this is called a hand roll or a teimaki. You'll see that a little piece of rice from off the roll here. Smash it a little bit. A little glue. Hand roll. This is the like one of the easiest ones to do, but it seems to take people a lot longer to learn than these other rolls. So there you go. Hand roll. Anybody hungry right now? Spicy scallop? All right, here's something I want to show you now, the toppers on the rolls, because a lot of people ask about that. So, and how do you do it? What do you do? Here's our tuna. This is spicy tuna. I'm just using this for an example. I'm going three little slices. You could put anything on here. You could put more spicy tuna on top of here. You could put your spicy scallop on top of here. You could put salmon on top of here. You could put your avocado all over the top of here. You could use a California roll and put mango on top or something like that, you know. It doesn't really matter. But the trick right here, so you have all this. Like, how do you keep that there? Plastic wrap. Over the top of it, makisu with no plastic wrap on it. And that's all we're doing. Just crimping it down over the top. Cutting a roll. Now that you're all experts at the rolls. Cutting the rolls, you're just going to dip your knife in a little bit of water, and you'll see us doing this. That just gets the water down. It keeps everything from sticking. I'm holding each piece and then cutting. And that's it. I like to reform it so it looks all pretty. Put your sauces on it. Do whatever you want. So that's spicy tuna with spicy tuna with tuna on top. Real basic, real easy. Remember the main thing you want to do is have fun, do the prep, have a party at your house, invite your friends over, show them a little bit of stuff, and then kind of learn it's fun. As long as you do all the prep work, it's fun. Because this, look, I spent an hour and 10 minutes talking about the prep, and it would have taken me a minute to make these four rolls, five rolls, you know what I mean? So that's what you have to remember. The devil's in the details, like everything else. Can you see that? So you got, pretty roll, whatever. Yeah, and then you could get dishes or what, but these, just plastic, nothing special. Any other questions? That's it. I think we're at time. I don't know.
What if you wanted to deep fry one of those?
Deep fry. If you want to deep fry, right here, I would use either one of these or one of these. We use tempura batter. Drop it in the fryer. If you wanted to put, like, next door we have a roll called the Las Vegas roll. That's definitely a favorite. So Las Vegas roll has rice on the outside. Here's how tough it gets. We put it in tempura batter. We roll it in panko. We put it in the deep fryer. That's all you have to do. Remember, if you're doing it, you don't have to roll it. You could three-step bread it, you know, flour, egg, and then panko. But if you're deep frying, you know, it's that easy.
Do they do that in Japan, or is that an American twist on?
Any roll with rice on the outside is an American roll. They don't, in Japan, in Tokyo, you could probably get some stuff like that, but it's not common.
It's not.
Same with the cream cheese?
Yeah, cream cheese, not a lot of cream cheese and rolls in Japan. just one of those things, you know. Finn, you hungry? Four.
What is shiso leaf?
Shiso leaf, it's the one thing on there. We happened to run out last night. It is a little leaf. I haven't, at Bay Market, you could find it. It's a little leaf. It's shaped, I don't know, kind of like a, it looks like a tomato leaf almost. And it's got a mintiness to it. It's really unique and unique to Japanese food. If you have sashimi assortments, you'll definitely see it behind the tuna and stuff like that. Again, just one of those specialty Japanese items and flavors. Yeah, and one quick note, Bay Market, I don't know if I put it on there. Thursday is their produce day at Bay Market in general. So if you want to get some good Asian-y produce. What's that?
Where is that market?
It's on Sprague. Closer to downtown, just past Northwest Eden Pet. The ginger is pickled, and we have an extra sheet there. I don't know if you got it. We printed it up on that, and it says naturally the ginger, if it was young, it would turn pink in the pickling process. Well, now they use dyes, and it says that they use beet coloring and stuff like that. I found that they don't do that, so I just like the all natural white. Less dyes, as much as you can. Remember, just try to eat a little more organic, try to eat wild as much as possible. I know it's starting to become tougher and tougher, but that is kind of an important process in all of this, you know, so. What?
My favorite is your spicy tuna sashimi.
Yeah.
Is that seven spice, what the seasoning is on that?
Yeah, the spicy love that we put on there. Yeah, it's a doctored up sriracha with vinegar, soy, mirin, togarashi in it. So again, great spice to get. And any other questions or anything? And
the poke that you have,
yeah,
same as sashimi, basically.
Poke.
Just doctored.
The poke's a sashimi, basically. Yeah. Which, you know, it's a take. I worked with a lot of Hawaiians over in Seattle as well, and that's just something that they showed me. It is always against the grain. And that's the next thing, you know, I hope you guys learned a little bit of stuff, and it was good. I would love to do another class, a little smaller, a little more hands-on, and then if you've come to this class and you get the basics, it would be great to do one with fish and show you how to cut the fish. And basic things to look for in that. I know we only touched a little bit on it, but we only have so much time, and you know, we just want to get you through basic roles so you get home, play around with that. And the next one, if you think it'd be something you'd want to do, you know, we'll talk about it and we'll show you fish. Will be the next one. So thanks for coming out though. Appreciate it. And we do have some tasters over here that you can grab. Somebody can grab this. I'll cut these up and make some hand rolls if you guys want a snack and go.